Good morning, church. Oh, I'm going to switch it. Do it this way. Can we hear? Yeah, okay. I'm going to try that one more time. Good morning, church. Isn't Sabbath a great day? And we get to have one every week. I remember Sabbaths when I remember Sabbath as a child and a young and a teen and so forth. I'm getting quite an echo. Is there a way to correct that? As a child and a teen, I remember Sabbath after church. Lots of food on the table, lots of people around the table. Visiting, sharing. I remember with my kids from the first week that they were born, being in cradle roll. And I remember particularly the first Sabbath my youngest was in church, the week that she was born. And we had her in this seat. In those days, we didn't have car seats, but it was a seat of sorts, and she was sitting next to her big sister, so they started early. I remember my dad's last sermon. He talked about, is God's grace sufficient for you and for me? I remember the Sabbath of his funeral. A freezing cold winter day. I remember spending time with my mom Friday nights and Sabbath afternoons with Gaither DVDs on and singing along to all the songs. I remember the Sabbath morning my husband died. But he died knowing Jesus. Sabbaths are actually a very beautiful time. A time for us to recognize what God does in our lives and what he's given us. So before I begin the rest of the talk, I'd like us to take a moment for prayer. Father in heaven, you have gifted us with your word. Pray that the words today will be from you, that we will open our ears to hear your word, that you will bless it and create in us new hearts, hearts that are willing to serve you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So the Sabbath that we're talking about today is not just Sabbath, it's a whole weekend of events. And in order to understand that, even in part, this Easter weekend that is about the Christian community, we must begin with some background information. Even then, there is far more to this whole story than we can ever tell in the short time we have here today. It's a story from Genesis to Revelation. So consequently, today we're going to cover the story of what this weekend means to Christians as an overview and not with all the details. And we've already heard a number of the details of what the weekend is about and what's been presented today. And I want to thank those who participated up front here today. I thoroughly enjoyed the music and the readings. And I think so many times a lot more can be said in songs than in words. There is so much more to the story than what we can tell in a short time that we can spend eternity trying to learn all about it. So, since we're not going to cover it all today, I would encourage you to look up the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and read the stories at the end of each of those books about Jesus' life, his death, his resurrection, his ministry, and seriously consider what it's all about. The story of what we celebrate this weekend begins even before creation. The plan for our salvation was put in place before the creation of this world. God created a perfect world, and man and woman were created perfect. Then Genesis 3 tells us what happened next. Enter the serpent, Satan. The fall of mankind into sin. Rebellion against God. As a result of the sin of Adam and Eve, the Bible tells us that we are born in sin. Now, I'm sure most of you have your Bibles with you, so I'd like you to turn with me to Psalm 51, verse 5. Psalm 51, verse 5. So the King James Version says, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." Another version says, "I was born a sinner, yes, from the moment my mother conceived me." Sin is the enemy of God. As sinners, we are born enemies of God. So let's turn to Romans 5 in the New Testament, Romans chapter 5. Verses 10 and 11. Romans 5, 10 and 11. "For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, but we also joy in the Lord through..." "We also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement." We have no ability of our own to even recognize the goodness of God. But this is where grace and mercy come in. Grace is an undeserved favor and cannot be earned. Mercy is giving forgiveness or the act of withholding deserved punishment. We are so buried in the quagmire of sin that we cannot think to get out of it on our own. In essence, God has to reach down and pull us out of this mess. Through the prompting of the Holy Spirit, our thoughts are directed heavenward. For some, this recognition of God happens quickly. But for others, it can take a long time. There is no set standard. But when the Holy Spirit speaks to us and creates a desire in us for God, the only thing we can do is receive it. It's the moment we understand we need the salvation that Jesus offers us. It's not something we can earn. Yet again, this is where God's grace and mercy come into play. When we realize that our only hope is in this salvation through Jesus and receiving this gift God offers us, our lives begin to change. No longer are we enemies of God. God grants us this undeserved favor of life, eternal life, and withholds our deserved punishment, death. Let's turn to Romans 6, the next chapter, Romans 6, verse 23, and I'm sure most of you know that one. Maybe we can say it together. Romans 6, 23. "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Death is what we deserve, but we are given life. This is incredibly good news. This is the gospel. We should be shouting it from the rooftops. And then out of gratitude for what God has done for us, we serve him and do good works to give glory to him. So this all began in Genesis. Fast forward now about 4,000 years to the time of the New Testament era, and we have the eyewitness accounts of the life of Christ. All four Gospels tell of Jesus' life, his ministry, his death, and resurrection. During his 3 years of ministry, he was constantly having to deal with the efforts of the religious leaders to trap him into saying or doing something they felt they could convict him on. The leadership consisted of Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, and lawyers. These leaders had knowledge of the law and could draft up legal documents. Also, there were elders, and they were the consulting body of the city, the nation, or the king, respectively, and as such were considered the wise. And then there were the priests. Israel's priests had two main purposes: to keep contact with God in the holy place of worship, that would be the tabernacle and later the temple, and to teach the people of the holiness of God and God's law, grace, and mercy. These were all persons who held legal and political power among the Jews. On the night of the Passover, Jesus met with his disciples in the upper room for the Passover meal. During the meal, Jesus spoke about what was about to happen, that one of them would betray him. And he said to Judas, "Go and do what you must," at which point Judas left. Now let's turn to Matthew 26. And we're going to look at a number of verses there. Matthew 26, and we're going to start with verse 14. Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priests. I'm going to read verse 15 as well. And said unto them, "What will you give me? And I will deliver him unto you." And they covenanted with him for 30 pieces of silver. Matthew calls him Judas Iscariot. It may be that he was Judas of Kyrios, a city in southern Judea. This would then make Judas the only Judean among the other disciples, who were all Galileans. Now, some wonder if Judas resented the leadership of the Galilean fishermen among the disciples. After all, Peter, James, and John were in Jesus' inner core of the group and were all fishermen. And perhaps Judas had had enough of it. Perhaps Judas was disillusioned with the type of Messiah that Jesus revealed himself to be, wanting a more political conquering Messiah. Perhaps Judas watched the ongoing conflict between Jesus and the religious leaders and concluded that they were winning and Jesus was losing. Therefore, he decided to cut his losses and join the winning side. Perhaps he came to the conclusion that Jesus simply was not the Messiah or a true prophet, even as Saul of Tarsus had originally believed. Some even suggest that Judas did this from a more noble motive, that he was impatient for Jesus to reveal himself as a powerful Messiah, and he thought this would force Jesus to make his move to take power as king. I do not know what his reasoning was. Whatever the specific reason, scriptures present no reluctance in Judas and only one motivation: greed. The words he had asked the religious leaders, "What are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you?" After the meal, Jesus and the remaining 11 disciples went to the Garden of Gethsemane. When they arrived, Jesus took Peter, James, and John a little further from the rest of the disciples. Now, I know most of you have heard this story a multitude of times before, and I am only touching on a few points, but I would like us to consider closely what transpires next. Matthew 26, 36 to 38. Then cometh Jesus with them to a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray yonder." And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then he saith unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. That's the King James. And in the King James, the words sorrowful, exceedingly sorrowful, is a rather weak translation for a phrase which contains Matthew's favorite word for violent emotion, even shock. The battle between good and evil was elevating quickly. Jesus knew there was a task ahead of him to complete, and he was feeling the extreme pressure of it. Jesus prayed earnestly. The ominous task before him filled his whole body. Luke tells us in Luke 22, 43 and 44, an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. A doctor I knew explained to me once about how close to death a person is when blood starts coming from their pores. He had seen it a few times in the emergency room, but only once had he seen a person survive it. I don't have a medical background, so I can't even begin to tell you about it. Others can probably do much better. So I'm not even going to try to explain it medically. But this was the level of Jesus' distress, and he hadn't even been arrested yet. Jesus' distress was to the point of death. Sweating blood, near death already. If not for the angel coming to strengthen him, he might have died that night. But the plan was for him to be the sacrificial lamb of the Passover. It was all in God's timing. Now, was it just the agony of the torture he would be receiving causing this pressure on him? Or was there something more? Let's look at verse 47 in Matthew 26. Verse 47. And while he yet spake to Judas, one of the 12 came, and with him a great multitude with swords and staves from the chief priests and elders of the people. Judas, who had spent about 3 years with Jesus, traveling with him, given the ability to perform miracles, and was essentially the money manager for the group, and assumed to be the friend of Jesus, has now turned traitor. Judas was willing to turn over to the enemy the very person he had been learning from, living with, and supposedly cared deeply for. Imagine how gut-wrenching it would be if you found out someone very close to you had called the police and set you up for arrest when you knew you had done nothing wrong. Jesus was hauled off to a sham of a court case. It began in the house of the high priest Caiaphas, and it began at night. The whole process was massively illegal according to Jewish law. Luke tells us that while in custody here, Jesus was mocked and beaten, then blindfolded and asked, Prophesy, who struck you? They also said many other things and blasphemed him. This nighttime trial was incredibly illegal, according to the Sanhedrin's own laws and regulations. According to Jewish law, all criminal trials must begin and end in daylight. Therefore, though the decision to condemn Jesus was already made at Caiaphas' house before dawn, they conducted a second trial in daylight because they knew the first one, the real trial, had no legal standing. This was only one of many illegalities made in the trial of Jesus. According to Jewish law, the decisions made in the official meeting place, which would have been the Sanhedrin meeting room, were valid. That first trial was not in the Sanhedrin meeting room. According to Jewish law, only an acquittal could be issued on the day of the trial. Guilty verdicts had to wait one night to allow for feelings of mercy to rise. According to Jewish law, criminal cases could not be tried during the Passover season. According to Jewish law, all evidence had to be guaranteed by two witnesses who were separately examined and could not have contact with each other. According to Jewish law, a false witness was punishable by death, yet nothing was done to the many false witnesses in Jesus' trial. According to Jewish law, a trial always began by bringing forth evidence of the innocence of the accused before evidence of guilt was offered. None of this happened in Jesus' trials. Barclay says these were the Sanhedrin's own rules, and it was abundantly clear that in their eagerness to get rid of Jesus, they willingly broke their own rules. Jesus went from trial in Caiaphas' house, which was attached to the temple, to the Sanhedrin meeting room at the temple, to Pilate, to Herod, and back to Pilate. Now Matthew 26, 69 to 75 tells us about Peter, and we're not going to take the time to read the whole thing right now. But it says, now Peter sat outside in the courtyard. While the trials were taking place with the Jewish leaders, Peter is trying to stay unnoticed and still able to see what was going on. Three times someone took notice of him and suggested that he'd been with Jesus. Each time he vehemently denied it, and the third time he began to curse and swear, saying, I do not know the man. Immediately a rooster crowed, and Peter remembered Jesus' words to him. Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Peter went out and wept bitterly. His remorse was great, and he was totally humiliated. He had declared only hours before this, that even if everyone else left Jesus, he, Peter, would go to his death for Jesus. And many years later, he did just that. Then Matthew 27 tells us about being before Pilate. Pilate saw the strength and dignity of Jesus, and he knew this was no criminal or revolutionary. He knew that it was no just charge that brought Jesus before his judgment seat. It was only the envy of the religious leaders. But Pilate dared not risk an uprising of the people. So when asked what he should do with Jesus, the mob reply, led by the religious leaders, was, crucify him, crucify him. Jesus was handed over for crucifixion. First, he was flogged, whipped till the flesh was ripped from his body. He was stripped and a purple robe and a crown of thorns were put on him, and he was mocked. He was spit on and hit on the head again and again. Then when he was hardly recognizable as the one who had taught the people, healed the sick, and raised the dead, he was led to the place of crucifixion. There, spikes were pounded into his wrists and the arches of his feet, and he was hoisted up to be viewed by any onlookers. Imagine for a moment if that was your child, and you knew that he was innocent. Jesus' mother, Mary, was there. Or what if it was your best friend? We knew John was there with Mary. Any one of the abusive treatments that Jesus received would probably destroy us. From noon till about 3 in the afternoon, darkness covered the land. And that time, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? A few moments later, Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave up his spirit. Jesus died.
Jesus died. Perhaps somebody doesn't want us to hear this. Jesus died. All the evil realm exulted over their victory. But did he die from the abuses dumped upon him? Partially, I'm sure. But mostly he died from the weight of the sins that you and I have committed, are committing, and will commit. Those little sins like putting someone in their place who really deserved it. And the most heinous sins that are committed by anyone who receives salvation. Every sin of every person who receives Jesus as their Savior, those sins separated him from the Father. Those sins he bore were horribly repulsive to a just and holy God. Those sins were the enemy of the Father. The Father had to turn away from him, from those sins and from Jesus who bore them. He had to let Jesus die separated from the Father. Jesus went through that so you and I could live. We deserve none of Jesus' life. What we do deserve is what Jesus got before death and in death, being separated from the Father. It seemed all hope was gone with the lifeless body of Jesus hanging suspended between heaven and earth. His body was taken down and placed in a tomb. Silence. But after resting in the tomb for a day, then came the morning. Oh, glorious morning. Suddenly the earth reeled and rocked under the feet of the guards who had been set to watch that the body was not stolen. God's angel came down from heaven and rolled away the stone in front of the tomb. Shafts of light blazed from him, and his garments shimmered snow white. The guards fell as dead men. The angel told those who came to the tomb, "He's not here. He has risen." Jesus was not stolen. It was righteousness reclaiming its power against the sins of this world. The most glorious news for each of us. Death and the grave were conquered. The offering of the Passover lamb was complete. Then came the morning.
Proud of you, buddy.
They all walked away, nothing to say. They just lost their dearest friend. All that he said, now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they'd seen. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail, how could a night be so long? Then came the morning. Night turned into day. The song was away. Hope rose with the dawn.
angel, the star, the kings from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine. Now it was done, they'd taken her son, wasted before his time. She knew it was true, she'd watched him die too. She'd heard them call him just a man, but deep in her heart she knew from the start, somehow her son would live again.
Death had lost. Life had won. That morning solidified the offering of restoration with God to each one of us. And salvation was sure. That is the good news, the best news ever. Our loving God and Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, our God who is just, holy, righteous, and all goodness rolled into one, had reclaimed his creation. What a blessed salvation he offers us. And what a hope, regardless of what happens here on this earth. And there's a lot going on now. A couple of weeks ago, the pastor talked about the goodness of God. God's goodness went to the extreme for you and me at the cross. Jesus had stepped into our mess in this world in order to clean us up. The day will soon be here when Christ returns, and we can stand together before him and declare, he is our God, we have waited for him. Another glorious day that will turn into eternity. I pray that we will all be together on that day. If you haven't as yet accepted this gift of God, I beg you to do it. If you need to talk to somebody, talk to the pastor, talk to somebody from the church about taking that step. If you are a person who feels that you have stepped off the path, I pray that you will seek God in getting you redirected. This is the most precious gift God has ever given us. I'm going to ask the song leaders if they would come up to lead out in the closing song. Oh, is there a special music first? Oh, okay. Sorry, I missed that. Oh,
They tell me Jesus died for my transgressions, that he paid the price a long, long time ago. On that hill called Calvary, he paid his price for me. But there is something else I want to know. Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Does he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain when I know I've got to change? I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. It seems that I'm so good at breaking promises, that I treat his precious grace so carelessly. But each time he forgives, what if he relives the agony he felt upon that tree? Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Does he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain? Then I know I've got to change. I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, every time I fail, can you hear the crowd cry, crucify again?
Let's stand for our closing hymn. Number 341, To God Be the Glory.